Hi everyone, it's been a while since I've done one of my edition comparisons, and it's been a while since I've done a Tintin video, both of which are pretty popular with most of my regular viewers and subscribers. So I thought that for today's episode, I could combine them to do yet another Tintin edition comparison, in which I look at Cigars of the Pharaoh, looking at both the original 1933-1934 version in the black and white facsimile edition published by Casterman, as well as the colored and redrawn version that most of us are probably more familiar with. I've done a couple of these comparisons before that were very popular. I've looked at the Black Island and Tintin in America, and I'll make a little mini playlist of these facsimile edition comparisons because I plan to do a few more, and I'll add them to that playlist, and I'll link that playlist up here as well as in the description below. For today's episode, I'm going to be using this ragged, falling apart, although taped up, Methuen paperback edition from my distant childhood, and this, you know, in considerably better shape, hardcover facsimile edition from Casterman. This video is probably not going to be as lengthy and as detailed as my previous two videos were, although I have a way of going longer than I planned, but I'll highlight a couple of differences that I find interesting, and if there's more that you'd like to know about, let me know in the comments below, and I'll be glad to share shorter videos or photographs in detail on our community page here on YouTube or our Facebook page, all of which I'll link in the description below. But for now, let's take a quick look at the differences and similarities between the original black and white version and the redrawn color version of The Adventures of Tintin, Cigars of the Pharaoh. Now, as I've mentioned in my previous videos, and as many Tintin fans will know, Tintin was originally, the first 9 Tintin stories were originally published in black and white and were later colored and redrawn to fit in the more evolved, popular style that Herge had developed by the 1950s. And Cigars of the Pharaoh was the 4th Tintin adventure, although I, growing up, knew it as the 2nd one, because Tintin in the Land of the Soviets and Tintin in the Congo were not available, so I knew Tintin in America as the 1st adventure and Cigars of the Pharaoh as the 2nd adventure. This was redrawn in the 1950s, long after Tintin had progressed beyond, 7 Crystal Balls and Prisoners of the Sun. And this was redrawn by Herge and his collaborators in Studios Herge to match that more modern style. That's obvious in a number of places, but most particularly in the way the ships, the boats, the airplanes, the machines are drawn, as well as, of course, the figures. And just like we'd seen in our Tintin in America video, the number of pages was also greatly reduced from the original. So the modern version that we know comes in at 62 pages, whereas the Casterman facsimile edition shows us that the original was at 129 pages, so more than double the length. But just like we'd seen in our Tintin in America video, this does not mean that there was a lot of story cut. Cigars of the Pharaoh does start over here with this full page plate, not like the color plates that we'll see later that were inserted in here, but a full page panel, which is absent in the modern redrawn version, substituted only with this one panel. But as the story gets underway, we can see that it takes in the modern version just one page to do what two pages are doing. So Tintin chasing the papyrus is only halfway through this page over here as it further continues with it blowing overboard and getting lost, whereas all of that takes two pages in the original. We are introduced to Egyptologist Professor Sarcophagus, who is sort of an early model of Professor Calculus, who we'll meet in later adventures, of course, but also the first appearance of Rastapopulous, a villain in the Tintin stories, obviously making his first appearance over here. But in this redrawn modern version, it is a little confusing because Tintin says, "Rastapopulous, I've got it, the millionaire film tycoon, and it's not the first time we've met," which is a really befuddling sort of declaration, because this is the first time that Tintin's meeting him chronologically. If we look at the original, where this encounter takes place several pages later, he just says, oh yes, of course, the millionaire film tycoon of Cosmos Pictures, without a remark of them having met before. That's one of the many touches in the redrawn version to have readers who've maybe been following along with the modern adventures and will see this in color and redrawn for the first time, make them feel as if this is continuing from the stories they've read, but it does create confusion for us modern readers who are reading them in order. Cigars of the Pharaoh introduces not just Rastapopulous, but also Thompson and Thompson for the first time into the Tintin universe, who arrest Tintin for being a drug smuggler and find drugs in his cabin, which is not something that is shown to us in the original edition. Rather, we just have a series of panels in which gossip spreads about how drugs were found on Tintin. The story in the original and the redrawn version proceeds in pretty much the same way, including one of my favorite transitions in the early Tintin stories, where he sees this boat outside the porthole with the pole saying, drift a bit closer, and the next panel has him sitting right next to this gentleman who's very surprised. And I was glad to see that it's exactly the same way it happens in the original. This sort of smash cut, jump cut thing is very effective, and I've always enjoyed it. Most of this redrawing follows the changes in art style and shapes, as well as, you know, the camera angle, as it were. It's a lot more sophisticated, a lot more modern than the more flat appearances, but these panels are obviously larger. There are many more panels per page in the modern redrawn version, which is part of what makes it thinner. But the beats the story follows are essentially the same, albeit over double the number of pages. Once they're in the desert and find the entrance to the tomb, we can see that the original has this rather strange thing in which I guess Snowy's carried off by a bat and Tintin chases him down the corridor. I'm not really sure if that's what's going on in that picture. Of course, the modern redrawn version has nothing like that and has just them walking down the corridor until they get to the row of mummified explorers. The names over here seem a little random. You've got M. Dupont, Sauerkraut, i.e. Rockcliffe, Lord Carnival, and then the two empty places for Tintin and Snowy. But by the 1950s, we see a little bit of an Easter egg where one of them is E.P. Jacobini, probably a reference to E. Jacobs, who drew the Blake and Mortimer series and was a collaborator of Herge's. One of the things I've always loved about the Tintin comics is their dream and nightmare sequences, and this is one of the earliest examples of it I had. And I was glad to see that the original was equally hallucinatory, and the way that it moves from image to image and the way things that he knows in his life are brought into his dreams during this gas knockout sequence are almost exactly alike. In most cases, the condensation of the pages by having more panels per page moves the story along faster, and I think of as improvements. But in this particular instance, with this big panel of the camels being led across the desert at night, which is a very beautiful but a very narrow caravan in the redrawn version, and particularly this panel of this boat loading the things onto the ship, which doesn't exist anymore in the redrawn version. They load it onto the lifeboat and then they're on the ship. This one sequence, this one panel is one that I really like. It's a very unusual angle as far as how close the camera is to the action and how much is being taken up. And this is one that I really miss in the new edition. The story in general over here is a lot looser. In this one, you have the Coast Guard coming, which is why they jettison the cargo over here. They just throw it off board for no reason. There's a lot more deus ex machina. When you read the original, you feel that things are being sort of made up as you go along. But that is something that carries over in the modern version as well. The story does have a lot more deus ex machina. It does have stuff happening that in later Tintins got more sophisticated and became much more polished. There is a hangover of these early stories, which makes Cigars of the Pharaoh one of the most interesting Tintins, because it looks modern, it feels modern as far as the art style is concerned, but you've got a lot of things going on in the story that you just wouldn't see after the Black Island, I think, anymore. The redrawn version of Cigars of the Pharaoh also introduced Alan, who would show up in Crab with the Golden Claws, as well as the other two Rastapopulous stories, Flight 714 and the Red Sea Sharks. It put him in here, so he actually appears in the second adventure as a henchman. Alan is not part of the original story at all. In fact, you don't even see the captain of the ship in the original. But over here, it's Alan who gets in touch with the nameless, faceless boss of this adventure. And I guess it creates a recall for the reader when he shows up in the crab with golden claws. Although him and Tintin never encounter each other, and so they don't recognize each other when they meet in Crab with Golden Claws. So you have Rastapopulous, Thompson and Thompson, Alan, all being introduced in this story. And another character who shows up for the first time is Senhor Oliveira de Figueira from Lisbon. He shows up over here and manages to sell Tintin a whole bunch of things. And this is one of those things that this story has, like, where did he get the money from and what happened to all these things that he bought? It's just a gag that's there in the middle of the story and that you forget about later. These are the kind of things that would not happen in later Tintins, but does carry over from the original version to the redrawn color version. I think for most people who read Tintin in order, one of the most confusing things about Cigars of the Pharaoh has to be the sequence where he meets Sheikh Patrash Pasha. When the Sheikh finds out that he is Tintin, he says, "For years I have read of your exploits." And you can see that the book that his henchman is holding up is Destination Moon, which makes no sense because Tintin has not even met Haddock or Calculus, let alone gone to the moon when this story is taking place. In the original Casterman edition, it was Tintin in America, the adventure of his immediately preceding Cigars of the Pharaoh, which makes a lot more sense. But from what I've read, this cover kept being changed according to whatever the latest adventure was. So when Cigars of the Pharaoh was originally being serialized in the magazine, this was Tintin in the Congo, because that was published as a book. Tintin in America hadn't been published yet. In this edition, it is Tintin in America. In this particular Methuen edition that I have from my childhood, it was Destination Moon. I'm not quite sure what the most modern edition of Cigars of the Pharaoh has over here. So if you have the latest edition of this book, I'd love to know which adventure is being pointed at over here. I completely forgot about another one of those confusing things where right on the very first page, Tintin saying our next stop will be Istanbul, we'll go ashore over there, and Snowy says, "I'd settle for Marlinspike." Again, Marlinspike is not a location that they have gotten to know yet. That's part of the Secret of the Unicorn and Red Raccoon's Treasure. But the modern redrawing has these little references where he says Marlinspike, where he says, "I've met Rastapopulous before," and most egregiously with Destination Moon over here, that make the redrawn version of Cigars of the Pharaoh such a weird Tintin edition. But also over here, we have the more familiar Snowy kind of conversations, a holiday at call it a deadly boar, and Tintin's just talking and Snowy's talking on, and you know, there's no actual conversation between them. The original stories actually had Snowy as an actual communicating dog. So he says, "Tomorrow we should reach Port Said," and he says, "So our voyage, is it over?" And Tintin says, "Of course not." This is one of those things that disappears completely and is edited out of the redrawn versions. As the story continues, we can see that it's not that radical a departure from the original, apart from obviously the style of the drawing and the art. The story beats continue to be exactly the same, but what the original facsimile edition does give us are these full color plates that Herge created for the collected edition. Just like Tintin in America, there are three or four of these color illustrations in this book that are just beautiful. Here's one of Tintin and Snowy in the coffins when they've been thrown overboard fishing, which is just before they catch the shark. This is one of them lost in the desert, which I find absolutely beautiful. And there's this one of them returning to civilization from the jungle later on in the story. I thought there was a fourth one. Yes, there is this one where Snowy is about to be sacrificed to Shiva in this Natraj statue. In both the original as well as the redrawn version, Rastapopulous isn't given to you as an outright villain, although there are some hints of that scattered through. He comes across as someone who wants to help Tintin. In the original, though, he reveals to Tintin that he's been tasked with finding the gunrunners and Tintin should report back to him. Something that gets toned down in the later edition where it's just Tintin narrating to him what's happened and him declaring that, oh, that's so unbelievable, it's like someone's out to get you. It's Thompson and Thompson in this one who let Tintin know about the gunrunners, whereas it's actually Rastapopulous in the original. One of the stylistic things that I found interesting is we have this where you get the sound effects that come through. We've seen this in other Tintins. They're coming through either the floorboards or the walls. It's about sounds that he can hear above him. Apparently, in the original, the art was done giving you a cross-section where you could see people moving above him. This is not something that we see in most Tintins, so I find this to be, again, like that close-up of the cargo being loaded on the ship earlier, I find this to be an unusual choice that we don't see repeated or just vanishes from Tintin, as far as I can remember. Please let me know in the comments below if I'm missing something, and we do have cross sections of this type in modern redrawn versions of Tintin as well. As I said, there are differences in the art style, but the pacing remains the same and the plotting is more or less the same. But one thing is that in the redrawn version, he's walking around lost in the desert, his bottle gets shot, and then he finally arrives at a town. He finds a town next to an oasis. In the original version, it's the same kind of wandering around, but we're told that he reaches Mecca, the holy city of the Muslims, forbidden to Europeans. This is just one of the unusual things in the original, where he's in Mecca and he can't be found out as a European, although all he does is really wear a scarf. You would think that they'd be able to see that he's a white Belgian. But it does get mentioned later when someone says, call the guard, it's a Christian. This is changed to, it's a dead spy. So the fact that he's European or that he's Christian, this is Mecca, all of those things are gone from this version. Here's one of those things where the redrawing gives you art and set pieces that are just gorgeous. This right here is one of my favorite panels from the early Tintin stories. As you might expect, this goofy part in the forests of India where Tintin helps out an elephant and then they talk amongst each other and decide to keep him as the doctor for the elephants, and he carves a trumpet and he starts talking to them through that. All of this is exactly from the original. It's been redrawn, but the slightly nonsensical aspect of it is definitely a trademark of the earlier stories. You would never have, again, things like Tintin talking in elephant language, you know, even boiling down to that notes of the trumpet meaning yes and no. This is all very playful and silly, but completely incongruous with the sort of rollicking adventures that we're more familiar with. And these are the other sections that make this such an unusual adventure for me. The artwork reminds you definitely of the foliage that you see in the South America stories, or Tintin in Tibet, in other parts where he's, you know, traveling from India to Nepal, and you see the modern style in the figures and the expressions, but the words that they're saying or the dialogue that they're exchanging is quite silly. Tintin himself comes across as quite rude or abrasive at certain times, stuff that he never does in later adventures. But the story is pretty much exactly the way it was in the original. But there are so many things over here that I think are reminiscent of the Black Island. Walls, trees, trains, tunnels, and of course Thompson and Thompson chasing him. Snowy with the sacred cow reminds me of Snowy with the goat in the Black Island. Again, preserved completely from the original. Towards the end of this book, you really pile on the deus ex machinas. You've got Thompson and Thompson pretending to be Shiva and rescuing Snowy. A tiger that jumps at them, and then Tintin is somehow able to subdue it and save the Raja. But right before the very end, there is an extended sequence in the original that is completely removed from the redrawn version, that of anything to do with snakes and cobras. So after the fakir and the elephants and the tigers, the snake charming and the snake part of it is the one India cliche that they decided to do away with for the modern edition. Over here, when Tintin discovers the hideout, the first thing he encounters are a whole bunch of snakes coming out of this. Then he distracts them with a bar of chocolate, because sure, gets away from them. He also encounters some crocodiles over here, none of which happens in the redrawn version. He simply goes down and that's where he is. And the last big change between these editions happens at the very end with them being rescued again by Thompson and Thompson. The Fakir gets away, but apparently he's rigged the place to explode, but Snowy has defused the fuse by peeing on it. Snowy peeing and putting off the fuse is not part of the modern Cigars of the Pharaoh, but it does show up in a different adventure. And then you've got this other sequence in which Tintin is asleep and a snake is led into his bedroom to kill him. And Snowy realizes this and runs away to the gramophone and puts on a record called the Snake Charmer Ethnic Orchestra, which mesmerizes the snake so Tintin has enough time to get out of bed and shoot it dead. None of that happens over here. I do think there are a lot of endings to this story. The kidnapping right at the very end, for example, the story really should have ended by then, but you think you know who you're going to find out who the villain is, but then he falls off the cliff. Of course, he's going to return and be revealed in the Blue Lotus, but you do get this wonderful little elephant parade in both editions to end the story. You've got the one final twist of the opium and the drugs in the cigars being revealed, literally in the last panels of the issue, but it's not a cliffhanger, even though the Cigars of the Pharaoh does serve in many ways as part one of a two-part story, the second being The Blue Lotus. The Blue Lotus is also one of those stories for which I have a Casterman black and white facsimile edition, so whenever I get a chance next, that's the one I'll be doing. I hope you enjoyed this quick video. Leave me all questions and comments below. Let me know if you'd like a closer look at something over here, as I mentioned on the community and Facebook pages for the Love of Comics. Thank you as always for watching, and I'll see you at the next video.